This had better be the most important video that you've ever watched. And I will do everything I can to make it be exactly that, because the polarity game in the world is reaching a crescendo. It's reaching a breaking point, actually. We don't really need the polarity game. This is what I will explain to you. And beyond that, I will explain to you that you do not need to have explained to you what you are. What you are is recognized directly. And in prayers yesterday, the answer came this morning to me about what to say. First of all, we can start off with a declaration and say this: I live in an enlightened paradise. I live in a paradise where everything is enlightened. Everything I see directly reflects what I am to me. I dwell in an enlightened paradise where everything I see directly reflects what I am to me. That is literally the solution. Now, we will work through the puzzlement of that in this video. What does that mean? The fact is that we are saved by grace entirely. What does that mean? It means that God recognizes what we are directly instead of indirectly. What we're trying to do is demand that God recognize us indirectly through looking at all our imagined creations, everything we've imagined, this world, the bodies, everything, and then recognize us through that. That's like saying we are recognized through an explanation of what we are, that we have to know what we are through an explanation. The fact is that what we are cannot be known through an explanation, okay? And what we can do is we can say to everything we perceive, you no longer have to explain to me what I am. I now release you from that burden, and you can directly reflect to me what I am. What the polarity game is it is buying time. All it's doing is buying time and saying, as we look out on our world that we're perceiving, we say to everything, you need to explain to me what I am. You need to explain to me what I am. What does that do? It buys time. It is simply what we're doing. We're buying time. And in my other videos, I've explained, why are we buying time? See, we are buying time. We're stalling. We're delaying. We're saying, I need a little more time to become Prime Creator. I need a little more time to get used to annihilation. I need a little more time. So how do we buy time? We say to everything we see, you tree need to explain to me what I am. And see, I'm not getting from you what I am yet. So you need more time to explain to me. The fact is, what we are can never be an explanation. It is always a direct knowing. Knowing is right now. And it's direct. You see, the Prime Creator knows what we are. The Prime Creator knows what it created. It doesn't need any explanation. It never looks to an explanation for what we are. It never looks for something indirect to know what we are. It knows what we are right now. But we're claiming that we don't know what we are. So I don't know what I am, but all this stuff, these things, is supposed to tell me what I am. And so we're expecting everything, the world, to tell us what we are. And of course, it fails in that. And we have this inner frustration and upset. We say, I don't know what I am. I don't know what I am. And that thing over there is not telling me what I am properly. And so we get into this polarity situation where, right now, for instance, in the United States, good old US of A, we have a polarity situation where half the people insist that they know what they are, but the other half has no idea what they are. See, they're crazy. The other half is crazy. Well, half of the USA says that we're sliding into tyranny. The other half says, no, we're not. We're going into a wonderful age, and that those who claim we're sliding into tyranny are insane. And we're so say that we're sliding into tyranny, say, oh, we're sliding into tyranny, and those who think we're going into a wonderful age, they're insane. That's a polarity situation. A polarity situation is where you feel you're right, and those out there, their explanations are insane. They're completely wrong. They're insane as far as their explanations go. The resolution to a polarity situation, which we're in right now, a very bad one, is for true sanity to present itself to the world. And then people on both sides of the polarity situation can say, well, wait a minute. In comparison to this, we're both insane. Both sides of the polarity, they would say, in comparison to this, we're both insane. And so let's drop this pointing fingers at each other saying, I'm right and you're insane, therefore I need to triumph over you and destroy you to know what I am. We'll say, well, no. Let's back away from this. Let's both recognize we're both, in comparison to this sanity, we're both insane. So there's no reason for us to be trying to triumph over one another. That's ridiculous. Because there isn't a polarity situation. There isn't really any difference between us. So there's nothing to fight over, nothing to say that justifies a triumph, a defeat. And then we would all, in humbleness, go, hey, listen, we're both in need of sanity. Excuse me. It's early morning here. We would say we're both in need of knowing what we are. Neither one of us knows what we are. That would back away from the edge of this terrible conflict that is brewing in this world. And what sanity would tell you is you don't need to have what you are explained to you. It's revealed directly, not through explanation. And then you say, oh my gosh. And then there would be peace. There truly would be peace. And then you would literally be dwelling in an enlightened paradise. Because you would give a new purpose to the world. And the purpose that you give to the world would be that the world directly reflects to you what you are. It's a direct reflection. It's not an explanation. So you only need one explanation. And that is you need to have explained to you that you don't need to have what you are explained to you. That is the only explanation you really need. You don't need to have what you are explained to you. It's directly revealed to you. Okay? So the explanation is that you don't need explanations for what you are. That is the only explanation you need. But you definitely do need that one to get out of this polarity situation. Once you recognize and accept that you don't need any explanations for what you are, you need direct revelation, directly revealed to you what you are, then you're not struggling with a polarity game. You're not struggling with explanations anymore. As long as you believe that you need an explanation for what you are, you will always be stratified into the polarity conflict. Because nothing will satisfy, no explanation will satisfy, and you project the dissatisfaction out onto some out there and saying, these things out there are not explaining properly to me what I am. In fact, they're completely failing. I need to get rid of them. I need to change their explanation. And then you get into the whole command control game of polarity, which the world is locked into now so severely. My question is to anyone is always, well, first off, who do you recognize as being sane, as being totally sane? And that's immediate clue as to where they're at. Because if they cannot point to anyone, then you know they're locked into a polarity game of needing to defeat someone to triumph, to make them feel that they've gotten rid of the wrong explanations. No, it's explanation itself that's the problem. What we are is completely beyond explanation. It's directly right now. Explanation takes time. What we are and have always been is perfectly, directly known right now. All right? So, it's incumbent upon everybody to at least know someone who's completely sane, who's totally sane. Whoever that may be, it doesn't always have to be the same one, because sanity can appear in this world using many different bodies and different cultures and different times and places. It's always available. But you should have at least one that you know is sane, that has been in the world or is in the world now, that was entirely sane. And then you know, say, oh, in comparison to that sanity, I know that I am struggling with insanity, and therefore I should not be caught up in attacking someone else. I say, wait a minute, let me first recognize what is true, and then we'll see. But at this point, I'm in no position to be judging others as far as them being needing to get rid of or triumph or defeat them. Let us be humble. Let us have humble hearts. This is the basis of, for instance, the Christian edict of, we're all sinners. Let us come together here and say we're all sinners here, and we're all realize that we're missing something that is totally relevant, completely important. And what it is, we're missing the fact that God recognizes us what we are directly and not indirectly at all. And our demand that God recognize us indirectly through all our imaginings, all these imaginings of impermanence that we've imagined, is really a stalling for time. It's a buying time and saying, God, don't recognize me yet. I'm not done with what I'm trying to do. And what we're trying to do is to actually displace God. That's what time is all about. It's trying to displace God. So we go together wherever we go to pray. Together, people are coming together and saying, we recognize that we're missing something completely fundamental and basic. And let us then spend our time working on that instead of trying to triumph over others and control others. So on that basis, there would be peace would come to this earth, at least there would be a great lessening of conflict and hatred, etc. When, for instance, when you go to a place of worship, you don't hate the people that are there. You realize the people are there because they have a recognition, too, that they're missing something, that something isn't right with their life. Something very basic and fundamental is being missed. There's something out of whack, entirely very out of whack. And they're recognizing that. They say, hey, I see that I'm struggling with something that is not sane. I'm entertaining insanity for some reason. Let me find out how I can set that down. That is, so they're all there saying, let me know how I can set this down. And they're listening to someone who's sane, telling them how they do it. And it's certainly not by triumphing over anything or anyone. So they naturally are peaceful in that regard. They're saying, hey, it's not by attacking someone that I regain my sanity or that I set my insanity down, the insanity I've been entertaining. It's not by attacking anyone. It's not by triumphing over anyone. So naturally, they're peaceful. There's at least recognition. So that is super important. It's all important that one, we know there is sanity. Someone has showcased sanity to us. And we know we don't have it. We're lacking that. And we get a sense that we need to set something down and say, okay, I've been carrying this burden. I don't need to carry this burden. I can set it down. And it's in setting that our burden down, that we're responsible for our insanity, not somebody else, you see. It's our wrong relationship with God that is the problem, not somebody else. So it's our responsibility to get our relationship with God right. And it's our problem. It's not somebody else's problem. It's not somebody else that's causing us to have a bad relationship with God. We're causing it ourselves. And so then you don't project blame out onto other people so much. You say, hey, whatever they do, the fact remains that I'm unhappy because my relationship with God is not proper. I've been trying to unseat God, and there's something wrong. I know that my relationship is not, I need to set something down, and I need to pay attention to sanity instead of going out there trying to triumph over others and claim that they're responsible for my unhappiness. And if only they changed, I would be happy. Say, reject that. Reject that and say, no, that is not true. That is buying time. That is simply buying time. I'm stalling. When I do that, I'm just stalling. I'm trying to buy time. I'm trying to figure out a way to be prime creator. When I'm buying time, always. When I'm buying time, I'm trying to figure out a way to defeat God, actually. And all these people I'm trying to defeat, they're just proxies. I'm just using them as proxies to defeat God. That's the way I'm trying to do it. So having these touchstones, cornerstones of sanity, is all important. It's all important. Now we can also have the inner guru, the inner Christ, the inner knowing, that we know that there's something within us that knows truth. That also is all important. Because also, there are sometimes that this perfect truth appears in a body here in the world, and we can recognize that too, externally. So once we have that, we say, I'm entertaining insanity because I know someone who's sane, and I'm not like them. I'm not like them. And what do they say? Those who are sane, what do they say? They say, I'm dwelling in an enlightened paradise. I'm dwelling in an enlightened paradise here. And you say, huh? What are they talking about? I'm not. What's the difference? Here's the difference. They have released everything, all things, which means all temporariness, all forms of gradual loss, from any demand that they explain to them what they are. And in doing so, everything then simply directly reflects what they are. No explanation, directly reflects what they are. And so they're dwelling in an enlightened paradise because everything is reflecting to them what they are. And they say, wow, I know what I am under all circumstances here. Everything is simply directly reflecting to me what I am. And that's an enlightened, perfectly enlightened being dwelling in paradise. So that is their secret. That is their secret. And so we're wondering, how do we do that? How do we do that? And we become interested in that instead of the polarity game. We're not interested in the polarity game. I'm not interested in that at all, really. Except that I see that it's not helpful. It's something to be avoided. I certainly recognize that. It's a sucker's game. It's a delaying tactic for those who want to be prime creator, who want to replace God as prime creator. It's a delaying game. They say, I don't know. They say, I can't know what I am. I have to have it explained to me what I am. And so I need a better explanation. I need everyone to reinforce the explanation of what I am. That's the problem. The answer is to say, I don't need to have explained what I am. I don't need it to have what I am explained to me. I need to have it revealed to me. What I am can never be explained. It can only be revealed. So I need to give up the demand that what I am be explained to me and accept that what I am can only be revealed to me. Because if we say what I am has to be explained to us, that means that we believe what we are is different than how God created us. It's different. Because as God created us, that can only be revealed to us directly. Because it's a totality. It's a totality. It has to be explained to us. We're insisting that what we are is different than what God created us to be. Therefore, we've been able to change what we are. So we're insisting on the world, our environment, everything out there to explain to us what we are. We're really insisting that we have changed what we are. We're no longer what God created us to be. And so we're denying the authorship of God. We're denying that God is prime creator. So insisting on an explanation of what we are is really a direct denial of God as prime creator. It really is. And conversely, when we say, no, God, I accept to have it revealed to me what I am. We're saying, God, I'm still exactly as you created me. I wasn't able to change myself. And I'm tired of trying. I'm tired of this silly game of insisting that I've changed myself, which is insisting that what I am be explained to me. And insisting, therefore, on time, on words, on concepts, on actions, on all this stuff. I mean, I no longer, so we can drop that and say, it doesn't matter what is said, what is conceptually, what is done, all, everything that's taking place doesn't matter, because I dropped the burden of explanation from all of that, and I accepted that to have everything, all of this whole dream of my imagination of impermanence and time and the past to directly reveal to me what I am. I accept the direct reflection, directly revealing what I am. And so then I dwell in an enlightened paradise. That's why these great teachers can come in the world and say, I dwell in enlightened paradise right here, right now. Nothing has changed that in the slightest bit. And we're all puzzled by it. But no more, no more. We don't need to be puzzled by it. And yet we will be puzzled by it initially. But when I got this morning, I looked at it and I said, yeah, I like that. That's perfect. And it wasn't so much puzzlement, really. And it was a very rapid acceptance of it, saying, obviously, that's it. Obviously, of course, of course, of course, of course. We just assume that we're going to be puzzled by it and thrown off by it. But if you really check in with yourself right now, you may find yourself saying, yeah, I see that. That's obvious. It's not a big deal. I'm not really thrown off by it. It's just the polarity game tells us that we must be thrown off by it, as if somehow if we see the truth that we're going to be freaked out by it. The polarity game is demanding that as its basis for its continuation, saying, no, the truth will freak you out. You'll be completely confused by it. Not so at all. What I always find is when I see greater depth, it's kind of like, of course. I see it and say, of course that's true. What's the big deal? What's the big deal? Of course that's true. There's no confusion. How can the dropping away of confusion be confusing? It's not really at all. There's just maybe a temporary sense like of, what do I do next? Kind of like, how am I going to function next? I'm not quite sure. But the idea that we're thrown into mental confusion is not true at all. It simply is not true. It's a bluff. It's a bluff. We're saying, oh, I have to have this explained to me. In other words, I have to have the obvious explained to me. No, I don't. The whole key is to say, I don't need the obvious explained to me. I don't need it. The confusion comes when you try to explain what is obvious to you. When you try to explain to yourself what you are, that's when the confusion comes. That's when the frustration and the feeling of impossibility comes. Who says we need to have what we are explained to us? Is God saying that? Do we need to explain to God what we are? Does God need to explain to us what God is? Does reality need to explain to us what it is? Do we need to explain to reality what it is? Where is this demand coming from? Where is the demand for explanation coming from? It's coming from our desire to change what we are and to be prime creator. And it's a stalling game. It's a stalling tactic. Because obviously, trying to explain to ourselves what we are is endless. It's endlessly impossible. We go on and on and on and on and on saying, well, how do I explain what I am? How can I explain what I am? How do I do that? How can time explain eternity, timelessness? And so we're puzzled by that, and we spend all this time trying to figure it out. How can I explain what I am? And that's just a delaying tactic. Meanwhile, we're getting used to annihilation, gradual annihilation constantly, which is what all of this is really doing. So we're constantly getting used to death, gradual loss, gradual destabilization, trying to get used to it, trying to teach ourselves these lessons. Meanwhile, we're stalling, saying, oh, no, I'm not really into that. I'm trying to explain. I need to figure out what I am. It's a stalling tactic. That's all it is. So when you see it all, this is a stalling tactic. Then when you recognize the truth and say, I don't need any explanation of what I am. I accept directly what I am. There's no confusion in your mind. I don't feel the slightest bit confused upon seeing this. And be able to give this one explanation that we don't need to explain what we are. In fact, we cannot. It's a waste. It's just a stalling tactic. So we're literally one step away right now from dwelling in an enlightened paradise. Just one step away, which is to give up the demand that what we are be explained to us, and instead accept that what we are be directly revealed to us. That's it. That's the one step. One step away. We're one step away at this point right now. And that's a great place to be, and we need to be only one step away, because the polarity game is about to get very intense. Very intense. And so, but if we have this, realize we're only one step away, we don't get pulled into it. If we think, whoa, we're quite a few steps away, we'll get pulled into it. There's no question about it. We'll get pulled into this feeling that we need to, what we are needs to be explained to us, and then we'll align with which explanation seems to be the best one for us, the right one. And then we'll get caught up in saying, this is the only way, this is the only explanation. I mean, this is the right explanation, the other is the wrong one. And then we'll get caught up into the conflict, for sure. That's how intense it is now. So we need to accept we're only one step away. We need to accept we're only one step away. And what the great teachers do is they give us that feeling that, hey, I'm only one step away. I'm only one simple step away from resolving this. And then we don't get pulled into the polarity thing. We say, wait a minute, polarity thing. We say, wait a minute, I'm only one step away, so there is no reason for me to get yanked into this thing at all. You know? And I've certainly felt the polarity trying to pull me in, entice me in, and I say, no, I'm only one step away. I'm not going to go throw that away. If you knew you're only one step away, one simple step away, would you throw that away for something else? No way. No way would you do that. You wouldn't throw it away. Because you'd say, wait a minute. I'm just one simple step away from what I want. Why would I throw that away? For what? You see, well, the polarity game says, well, yeah, we're only one step away, too. And I say, well, that's good for you. But I'm not going to throw away the fact that I'm one step, simple step away, to try to grab some other one step awayness. That's a waste of time. That's a stalling tactic, obviously. So if we're only one simple step away, we're not going to discard that. We're going to stick with it. We'll say, no, I'm not going to change horses in midstream from some spurious claim that I can also get one simple step away, a better one. No. I'm one simple step away, and it's nothing, there's no better simple step away. This is it. I can set down the demand for explanation of what I am in return for direct revelation of what I am. That's the only choice I need to choose between. Always. Either I'm demanding that what I am be explained to me, or I'm accepting direct revelation of what I am. Again, I'm either demanding that what I am be explained to me, or I'm accepting the direct revelation of what I am. That's it. Those are the only two options that I have. That is the option. That is the choice. I only have one choice between those two options. Either I'm demanding that what I am be explained to me, or I'm accepting direct revelation of what I am. Okay? So, seeing this, you know you're only one simple step away, and everything else is extraneous to that. And is no, you don't need to entertain it. You don't need to entertain it. You only need to entertain this. I have one choice to make between only two options. Either I'm demanding that what I am be explained to me, or I'm accepting direct revelation of what I am. Now, what the great teachers do is they make you aware of this. Their presence somehow gives you that feeling, you know, really a profound feeling, and then you just say, oh, wow, I don't need to entertain any other step. This is the step, and I'm going to entertain it now. I'm going to entertain this question, this choice. What is my choice? And so all this other stuff is extraneous. You say, this is not focused, tightly focused on this choice that I need to make. It's not tightly focused on it. I feel I want to be tightly focused on this choice, making this choice. Okay, now what? Do I continue to demand that what I am be explained to me, or do I accept direct revelation of what I am? You say, I want to spend my time that way in considering this choice. Wow, I have this is the only choice there is. Only choice I need to make. One simple step away. And then you become less available to the polarity game, the blame game, the attack game, the war game, the imprisonment game, the demonization game. You become less available to that. Because when people want to talk about blah, 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 I say, whoa, wait a minute. I want to talk about this one simple choice that I have to make, and that's all I'm interested in, honestly. That's all I'm interested in. I'm not interested in the parties and the fun and all this stuff that the polarity game tells that you're entitled to if you just align with them. Knocking the heads of those that they don't like. No. You say, no, I have a simple choice, and I know that my happiness depends on making this simple choice, the right choice. And so I'm focused on that. Forget about the parties and the fun, and all the party girls and guys, and the triumphs, the fun we're going to have when we triumph over our opponents and all this kind of stuff. No, I realize that I don't really have an opponent. I have a simple choice between having it explained to me what I am, or having it revealed to me what I am. So if you've listened this far in this video, I believe you're getting a sense of this, like, wow. It's profound. You're getting a sense like, hey, you know what? There is real hope for me and for the world, but for me, certainly. And that's a sort of a staggering thing. You say, oh my gosh, I'm not going to fail. I'm not going to fail. I'm not going to go down with the ship. I'm not going to get caught up in the polarity game. Now, are the great revealers of truth in this world, are they nuts? Are they crazy? No. You say, wait a minute. Maybe they just simply chose to have revealed directly to them what they are. And they're just dwelling in this direct revelation of what they are. That's all. And whereas we are struggling with demanding an explanation of what we are from all these, from everything, we're demanding an explanation. And they're not. And that's the only difference. That's the only difference. And yet they seem so different from us, that we think, wow, maybe they're insane, maybe we're sane and they're insane, or someone someone is off their rocker here. I'm not sure, is it the teachers or we or is it us, you know? And then we say, wait a minute, maybe it's us that have been off our rocker. Maybe we are the ones maybe demanding an explanation of what we are. That's what's crazy. And yet we can simply, easily drop that demand. If you're getting there to you know, you will see someone who is perfectly sane, and you'll recognize it right away. You'll say, ah, I see that. That's sanity. I can see it. That's sanity. No question about it. And you go, okay. And then you start being available to that sanity. But again, it's simpler than we know. It's simpler, but we know it now. It's literally as simple as a simple choice. Do I choose to continue to demand that existence explain to me what I am? Or do I choose to accept existence to reveal directly to me what I am? That is it. That is it. You've come to the place of one-stepness right now. We are now in the place of one-stepness, just in time, because the polarity game is in the stage of one step into towards conflict right now, actually. And don't think that polarity games don't go into conflict. They most definitely do go into conflict. They most definitely do, because everyone wants to have resolution to what they are. And the polarity game sees an enemy that needs to be defeated in order for resolution to take place. So most definitely, polarity games go into conflict. Most definitely. Make no mistake about it. The only way they back away from that is to recognize sanity and say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe it's not about explanation. That's it. If you get any sense that, hey, wait a minute, maybe it's not about explanation, then you start stepping out of the polarity game, and then the whole thing starts, the tensions start easing up. They all start easing up. I've told the story. I'll tell once again of the Kumbh Mela in India, is where there's massive millions and millions of pilgrims and come from all over India to bathe in a sacred river. It's a symbolic thing of washing their sins away, and it's a great communion of everybody reinforcing their focus. And all these different groups have spiritual heads, and they kind of conflict about who's primary and who's secondary, and they have sort of rank of hierarchy, and they get into real spats and disagreements, really actually sometimes coming quite severe. Who has the right to most reverence, etc.? Who makes the decisions and the money and the property and the rituals and everything? It all gets kind of contentious, and sometimes it gets very contentious. Now, the great showcaser of sanity, Anandamayi Ma, would go to these Kumbh Melas. I know she went to, I don't know, seven of them, maybe five or seven, something. Went to a lot of them, and they'd set up a tent, and she'd just sit there. She'd just sit there. And these heads of these various denominations, as it were, of spiritual aspirants and devotees, they were in all this dispute, and she would invite them to come into her tent, and she'd just be sitting there, quietly just sitting there, smiling, hello, nice to see you, and everything. And they come in there, and after a while, they completely forget what their disputes were, and they would feel the most loving harmony with everybody there. And then they'd leave, and they don't even know, they wouldn't even remember that they were in dispute about anything. And then, of course, gradually their devotees will remind me, did you resolve the dispute? Did she tell you who's primary? It's all good. Don't worry about it. And the devotees will remind them, well, you know, when we go out, we want someone else to bow to us first, and then we'll bow to them, and who bows out to who first, and, you know, and how do we function? And you're supposed to tell us as the head, you're supposed to tell us all this. And they say, and the head would say, hey, it's all fine, it's all love, don't worry about it so much, it's not important, and we can all get along. And then gradually they'd have to get back into the trying to resolve the disputes. But the principle is this, that in the presence of sanity, we get this sense that what we are, we don't need to have it explained to us. We drop the demand that what we are be explained to us, and we see what we are, we can accept it be revealed to us, because there's sanity in it. She's saying, I dwelling in a perfect paradise, perfectly enlightened paradise, everything is revealing to me what I am. That's literally the truth. And they get the sense like, hey, this is the answer. We don't need to have what we are explained to us. We can drop this demand. We can accept what we are to be revealed to us. And then they go back and say, oh, it's so simple. We don't need to fight over explanations. All this fighting is over explanations. We don't need that. And so you see, the tensions ease. The tensions ease. They dropped. It eased off. So that is literally how it works. It is literally how it works. It's super helpful to have someone in the world who's enlightened. Super helpful. And they don't need to resolve any conflicts among the polarity. All they're doing is reassuring them that they can drop this demand for explanation of what they are. That's it. And that they can have revealed unto them what they are. That is all that is taking place. It's that simple. So you might say, how can anyone who's enlightened help the world? You know, it's impossible. No, it's not impossible. They don't have to go running around putting out fires and explaining to everybody what they are. No, not necessary at all. They just say, what I am is being revealed unto me, ceaselessly and perfectly and flawlessly being revealed unto me, even here in this world of temporary, imaginary thought forms. Unstable, of the world of complete instability, of a mirage of stability that's constantly breaking down. Even here, this mirage can directly reveal to me what I am. And is doing so right now. And then we just say, I get it. It's simple. I simply need to choose between my demand that what I am be explained to me and what I am be revealed to me. That's it. And so, this sense of, oh, wait a minute, it's simple, permeates the world, begins to spread out like a fragrance that doesn't dissipate. You know, it spreads out, this fragrance. We say, hey, wait a minute, it's all very simple. It's a simple choice for each one of us. We don't need to be tearing each other's hair out. Let's back off of that. Let's just sit down and start just sharing truisms with one another. And as we do that, we begin to get close. We bridge the gap, the continuity gap, between getting to the point we can simply say, it's a simple, the entire situation I'm in is just a simple choice. I have one simple choice to make. And there's no other choices that I have, really. And it's either I choose to demand that what I am be explained to me, or I choose to accept that what I am be directly revealed to me. That is it. All problems, everything, my whole experience simply depends on this choice, which way I choose, everything. And I can see that what I accept what I am, I can never be explained to me. Can never be a product of an explanation, the outcome of an explanation. And I'm trying to grasp what I am mentally. What we are is spirit. It's not some mental thing. It's not something that can be grasped mentally. It's revealed directly. And yet, all this mentalness can reflect to us, directly reflect to us what we are. When we give up the attempt to grasp an explanation. See, it's our attempt to grasp an explanation that is the problem. When we drop that demand that we grasp an explanation of what we are, then everything automatically directly reflects to us what we are. Even all this mentality, all the thoughts, all the imagining, everything here will then directly reflect to us what we are. Even all the death and disintegration, etc., will directly reflect to us what we are. We've given up the demand that the mind grasp what we are. You see, in creation, God created us as spirit, and then mind is the servant of spirit, which provides the experiencing of what we choose to experience. We want to choose presentation. Mind presents to us what we want to experience. But it's mind was not created to tell us what we are. Our mind was not primary, you know. Spirit, it was not created to have mind explain to it what it is. No, mind always directly reveals to spirit what it is. In other words, the experiencing of spirit is direct. Mind directly reflects to spirit what it is. And all these beautiful experiences, beautiful reflections. Spirit is always experiencing what it is, but in so many rich and beautiful, rich, glorious ways that mind is presenting. Mind is like this mirror that is reflecting spirit, what it is, but in all these beautiful ways. Now, how did we get into this situation that we're in, this crazy situation of thinking that we need to grasp an explanation of what we are? And I've explained that in previous videos over and over and over and over and over. And it just occurred to me, very simple how to explain it, but it's that explanation just backed off temporarily. So when that happens, don't struggle with it. Just say, okay. Because what happened was we wanted to be prime creators, which means we wanted to change reality. Reality is one indivisible whole. It can't be changed. The idea of changing it is actually the idea of annihilation of reality. So the effect that we got immediately, in other words, mind reflected immediately, direct immediate reflection, not an explanation, but a direct presentation, reflection of annihilation to us, which was symbolized as total mental chaos. Mind pretended that it was in complete chaos. It reflected a picture of total mental chaos to us. And we couldn't accept that, because then we would be without our presenter, a reflector of what we are, without mind. It is as if mind disintegrated, immediately disintegrated. Even though it didn't, it was just reflecting a symbolic picture of complete mental disintegration. And so Spirit says, I can't be without mind, because then I won't know what I am. I won't have anything to give me the experiencing as of what I am, you see? So then mind said, whoa, 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 whoa. I mean, Spirit said, whoa, mind, you can't do that. You have to express this idea to me differently. And then mind says, ah, there's a way. And then mind says, you can experience the past where you weren't what you are now, where you were something different, you see, where experiencing effects directly doesn't happen. Where there's time, where there's explanation, where everything's explaining itself to you. You're not directly experiencing it right now. It's all explaining it to you. It's a gradual explanation of what you are is taking place. So when we look at this world, we're seeing a gradual explanation of what we are. And we're saying, I want to know what I am now. This gradual explanation, I don't like it. But we say, well, it's certainly better than mind being annihilated. Annihilation of mind. Mind is saying, I'm not presenting what you are right now, Spirit. I'm gradually presenting. I'm gradually explaining it to you. You see? But we're dissatisfied with that too. We say, I don't like that either. But it's better than the disintegration of mind. And it's not immediate. It's not this immediate disintegration of mind. It's a gradual explanation. Mind's explaining its disintegration to us gradually. It's what this really is. We say, oh gosh, mind, I don't like this story. You know, it's just like, it doesn't end well, does it? You mean, you're just saying, you're not disintegrated yet, but you're on your way. It's a gradual disintegration. And mind says, well, I'm giving you time to get used to that I'm not going to be here anymore. I'm going to be completely disintegrated. That's what it is. But we can remove this burden from mind and say, oh, mind, I don't want to be prime creator. So therefore, I don't need to change what I am. I don't need to change reality. Therefore, you don't need to present your disintegration to me. Your disintegration, complete disintegration of mine, which would be also reflecting my own disintegration to me. You don't need to do that. So therefore, you don't need to defend against that by presenting a gradual explanation of what I am, or a gradual explanation of disintegration. You can reflect what I am right now directly to me. And you can even use all this past to directly reflect to me. No more need for explanation. You can reflect it directly to me what I am. So you see, there is this explanation behind, there is this cause and effect situation that can be explained to us. But that's not an explanation of what we are. It's an explanation of how we drop, why it's justified and right to drop, to make this choice, to have a direct revelation of what we are instead of explanation of what we are. Just 1 second here. All right, we're back. So the question is, do I understand how we got into this pickle? Is it understandable? Absolutely, yes. Absolutely. It is very clear. But that doesn't change at all the fact we're one simple step away. It doesn't change that at all. It's still exactly the same that we indeed have this choice, and we can set down the demand for mind to explain to us what we are. That never works. That never works. Because actually, that whole explanation of what we are is really based on mind gradually explaining to us our own annihilation, that we're no longer what we are, you see. That is actually what is taking place here. That is actually what we're entertaining. That's why it doesn't feel, it really feels, oh God, it feels, not only does it doesn't feel right, explanation not feel right to us, but what is being explained to us, we don't like it at all. We say, well, no. That's why we say we want a better explanation. It's not possible. Explanation is always what mind is explaining. As far as our identity, what we are goes, it's always going to be based on mind gradually explaining to us our annihilation. Instead of having it happen all at once, mind is saying, okay, I'll spoon feed it to you gradually. It has no choice. When we choose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, this is what mind has to do. Has to do. So don't blame mind for anything at all. Mind is functioning perfectly. It has no choice. It has to do this. But we have a choice, whereas we can choose once again and say, wait a minute, I don't want to be prime creator. I choose to accept myself as I am, accept reality as it is, and then mind does not have to reflect to you any your annihilation. It can reflect to you exactly what you are. It can reflect to you exactly as you are, and mind does not have to spoon feed it to you gradually, your annihilation. It can actually, all this gradual explanation can now be used to directly reveal to you what you are, directly reflect to you what you are. That's what mind will do then. So, it's we're in a fabulous position actually, because we've worked so hard to clarify. So, don't worry about the polarity stuff and the conflict stuff and all the stuff that is to come. It's, again, it's mind is actually spoon-feeding to us our own annihilation, trying to explain to us, instead of directly revealing our annihilation to us, which it has to do when we choose the idea of wanting to change who we are. It has to directly reflect to us our own annihilation, which it does by showing us its own disintegration, which would, meaning it has no capability to reflect to us what we are at all, which would, for us, it would, feels like annihilation. That's what mind has to do. But we don't have to hold on to this idea of wanting to be prime creator. We can exchange that for the idea of accepting ourselves as we are, and then mind has a different presentation to give to us. Very simple. But again, we can simplify it even more by saying we choose either to have what we are explained to us or revealed to us. With the slight caveat that really what mind is explaining to us what we are, it's really explaining to us our annihilation. That is what existence is actually all about, is gradually explaining to us our own annihilation, because we couldn't accept it all at once. We couldn't accept it being revealed to us. So we say, no, I can't accept this being revealed to me. So I want, at the time, mind says, I'll explain it to you gradually. So you live, you die, everything's dying gradually, this gradual disintegration. The universe is a gradual disintegration. Of course, everything that is formed is then formed for the purpose of showing us this gradual disintegration. So mind is spoon-feeding us bit by bit by bit this experience of annihilation, which we want to be really experience of us changing what we are so we can be prime creator. So again, there is a foundation of clarity upon which this choice rests, but the choice remains the same. Do I choose to insist that what I am be explained to me? Which really means this might the explanation is the explanation of my own annihilation. Do I really want that? Do I want to continue with that? Or do I want to have it directly revealed to me what I am? And mind can use all the staging that it used for disintegration because it's no longer being needed for explanation. So every moment can directly reveal to us, reflect to us what we are, what we truly are. Every moment here, doesn't matter what's taking place. That is no longer important. Only the direct reflectiveness is important. Because mind directly reflecting the spirit, what the spirit is the functioning of reality. And that's what we want to get back to. I mean, we have this continuity issue, like where we've forgotten how reality functions, because we're in this dream of gradual explanation, which is not how reality functions at all. Reality functions by direct revelation, directly revealing, direct experience, immediate direct reflection. And so we need to get back to that. So we need to have experience now of direct reflection. Right now, having reflection direct instead of explanation. So we need to experience that with everything that we've, all this forms of impermanence that we're dreaming. We can use that. What we need is mind directly reflecting instead of explaining. And then we'll say, everything is working perfect. Reality is functioning perfectly, and we won't be scared about functioning the way we were created to function. We won't be frightened anymore. But we have to have mind directly reflecting to us. Directly reflecting. That is the important issue at this point. Direct reflection instead of explanation. Directly revealing instead of explaining. Again, directly revealing instead of explaining. That is all important. That doesn't mean that we don't use words. Doesn't mean that at all. Because words can be very helpful, very useful, actually, to help us come to terms with this. Now, it may not be so important what is directly reflected to us. It's the fact that we're experiencing direct reflection that's important instead of explanation. That's what's important. That is what's important. So it's not like we say, I have to be in a beautiful place. I need to have a beautiful lake and then have that reflected to me. No, what's important is that direct reflection is taking place. That's what's important. It's not the content out there that's important. It's that direct, prior to any, more immediate than any explanation. It's that is taking place. That's what's important for us. That's why Ramana Maharshi could say, abide in the self, meaning that is actually direct reflection. Abide in this direct reflection of right now, instead of trying to follow explanations, as it were. So it's not, as far as all these things, these forms of impermanence that we're imagining, it's not important what particular forms are reflecting to us right now. That's not important. That is not important. It can be anything, anything at all. You can be any place at all, anything at all. The only thing that matters is that there's a direct, immediate reflection right now, instead of an explanation. So in other words, when you're looking at something, looking at a shrub there, all that's important is that I'm experiencing this shrub right now. It's a direct reflection of the shrub, instead of a explanation of that shrub. That's the only thing that's important. Or you can be looking at a leaf, a dead leaf there. All that's important is I'm looking at a direct reflection of that dead leaf right now, instead of an explanation of that leaf. So I see this is what A Course in Miracles is actually getting to. I just getting to it from a different angle, as it were. But that is what it's saying. It doesn't matter at all. Can a piece of bark, anything at all, just some flower petals here. It doesn't matter what it is, whether the world calls it beautiful or not is not important. The barbecue, barbecue cover, that barbecue cover is directly reflecting to me. I'm experiencing it right now, a direct reflection, right now, instead of an explanation. And it's that which is that we recognize is important, and is more than beautiful. It brings this vast relief, what we call bliss. The bliss might be said as to be just this tremendous relief and happiness. Like, all is well with my mind, and therefore all is well with me, and therefore all is well with reality. But as long as we think that the mind is insane, that it's disintegrating, that it's incapable of functioning, then we will be terribly frightened, like we're going to be annihilated. So it's really, we have to see the mind, that the mind is not crazy, it is not insane, and can directly reflect to us. That's all that's important. These temporary forms of symbols, really, everything, it's not important. Whatever. It's only important this piece of concrete. If you're looking at a concrete wall, it doesn't matter. This piece of concrete is directly reflecting to me. I'm experiencing direct reflection from this piece of concrete. And then you realize that you're saved. You're saved from this nightmare, terrible nightmare. So it is true. Wherever you are, you can be enlightened. You can be dwelling in an enlightened paradise. And you can realize you're completely saved and be in bliss. Wherever you are, that includes if you're in prison. Okay? It includes if you're incarcerated somewhere in a jail cell, solitary confinement. You're just as much capable there as somebody dwelling in a $50 million mansion in Palm Beach somewhere. Okay? Just as capable. Absolutely. Because you can look at that cinder block wall and experience it as directly experienced without any need for explanations. Concepts, explanations, you can directly experience that cinder block wall. And then your mind, you say, hey, mind, you're well. You're well, mind. There's nothing wrong with you, mind. You're giving direct reflection, you see, which is how reality functions, how the mind functions, how reality functions. Spirit without mind cannot experience itself. That's how creation is. God needs the Son of God to experience itself. It's a way of saying God needs the mind to experience itself. And just as spirit needs the mind too, to experience itself. That's how creation goes. And so if mind is destroyed or not functioning right, how can spirit know what it is? It cannot. Spirit knows what it is through its experiencing. Spirit is an experiencer of what it is. Spirit is always experiencing what it is, but in all these glorious, beautiful ways, you see. That's what God is doing too. It doesn't know what it is without any experiencing. It experiences what it is. That is creation. Creation is always experiencing what it is. That's the glory of creation. So if you try to take away this direct experiencing of what is, then you're in this nightmare of annihilation. It's terrible. So we need to be reminded that reality is still exactly as it is, and we still, mind is perfectly sane and functioning perfectly well. We have to get that through direct reflection. It doesn't matter what is directly reflecting to us. It doesn't matter. It could be anything, a piece of dust. You know, you hear the tales of the gurus, those who are enlightened, and they say all these different things of how they suddenly realize that everything is fine. Everything is, they're dwelling in an enlightened paradise, perfect. It could have been anything. These Zen stories of somebody, they're sitting there one day and they hear a cricket or something, and that's it. Why? They directly experience it. It's a direct reflection. Not mediated by concepts, not mediated by explanations, really. Not mediated by time, which is, you know, the past, explanations, all that, but okay, not mediated by explanations. You see, it doesn't matter, you don't need to name it that it's a cricket, or what the sound is, or anything like that. It's that you're simply directly experiencing it. Directly experiencing anything. Doesn't matter what it is. And so they all have different, you know, that's the great puzzle when you say, well, how they got enlightened because they heard a cricket, and someone else was walking along a street and a taxi cab splashed them with some water and they were enlightened. And you have all, you know, endless explanations, like, and you go, what in the world? How can I explain that to myself? And what's going on? So now you know what's going on. It doesn't matter what the form is. It only matters that there's a direct reflection taking place, a direct experiencing, as it were, direct reflection, without explanation. That the choice is, okay, I choose to have revealed to me what I am. Directly revealed to me what I am, instead of have explained to me what I am. So it's not the cricket that's doing the enlightening or anything like that. These forms are not doing the enlightening. It's the mind. It's spirit choosing the mind, saying, mind, okay, go ahead and directly reveal to me what I am. And then mind can use anything at all. It doesn't matter. There's nothing special about it. There's nothing special about that splash of water. Because if it was, that would require an explanation of why is it special. It's not. So we're coming around to all of this here very strongly, just in the nick of time. And people want to know, you know, they want to make a religion out of that cricket. They say, oh, okay, cricket. Now I can explain everything because you, cricket, are the number one, and then everything else is a relationship to you, and then they're trying to then get this explanation. No, there's no explanation of what we are. There is simply direct revelation of what we are. what's being said is like, well, I don't need to have explained to me that there's a cricket making a sound. There's no need for to have anything explained. I don't need that explained to me. And then you realize I don't need to have anything explained to me about what I am. It's all directly revealed to me what I am. And yet, prior to that, explanations are very helpful, not as to what we are exactly, but to why we don't need to have explained to us what we are. And more importantly, why have we demanded that we have an explanation for what we are? Why is that going on? That's where I come in. That's what I'm good at. Really good. I'm able to explain that, to clarify it for us, of what's going on here. With why are we demanding explanations, you see? Now, traditionally, it's said, don't even worry about that. But from my standpoint, I think it's actually quite helpful. In the long run, it's helpful. Otherwise, people will keep on spinning it, and demand some sort of explanation, even though it may be subtle. They'll get caught up in all these subtle explanations, which is a very bad delaying situation. What I see in the world is generally a lot of the teachers, gurus, etc., are caught up in subtle explanations. And that's not it. Instead of direct revelation of what they are, subtle explanations. And so, because they don't know, they're worried about, why do I need explanations? Maybe I need them. I just need a subtle one. I need a better one. And so there's religions and teachings and that are caught up in this. And so by being able to clarify the whole basis for all of this, then we say, we understand this whole thing. The explanations are really mind gradually spoon-feeding to us our own, its own annihilation. Mind is showing us symbolically its own annihilation, bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. And explanations are just a delaying tactic that's superimposed upon that, making us think that, kind of calming us down, like, oh, don't worry, this is all being explained to you, what you are. It's not. What we're trying to be explained to us is our own annihilation. That's really what's going on. So if you see that, that vaults you past all the subtle explanations that could possibly ever be given out. And then you can get free of all of that, and you save yourself an enormous amount of time of just having explained to your own annihilation assembly what's going on. That's all saved for you. Save time. This is a time saver in the big picture, you know. And of course, it's true that those who have this direct reflection of what, that bypass all explanation, direct reflection, mind directly presenting whatever is free of any explanation, that's enlightenment. Yes, it is. And it's right now. They say, well, we don't need any explanations at all. That is true at that point. But it's also true that very few have done that. Very, very few have accepted this, have set down demand for explanation and accepted direct reflection of what they are. Direct reflection coming from mind, mind directly presenting. Very, very few have accepted that. And so I wanted to understand and see, why is that? Why the failure is so severe? Why? Because they're caught up in subtle explanations, thinking that, yes, we do need explanation, but again, a real subtle, smart one is what's needed. And that's a dead end. That doesn't work. And so, but people need to explain, why doesn't it work? We keep thinking, now why, what's going on here? So I've been able to see all of it from the standpoint, again, the very beginning, spirit wanting to be prime creator, what the nature of reality is, the necessity of mind presenting annihilation, spirit, its own annihilation, spirit saying, no, I can't tolerate that, mind, I need you, mind, and then mind saying, okay, I'll present my gradual annihilation to you. And that's what mind is doing, and explaining to spirit, okay, this is how gradualness takes place, and spirit saying, I don't understand this gradualness. I don't understand explanations. That's totally weird. But that's all that mind can do, you know, with this idea. So this again, seeing this, I say, no, don't need any subtle, clever explanations. That's all a waste of time. The entire thing then, the whole context is set, and then we can see, oh, of course, this is, yeah, I need to be enlightened. I need to accept mind, direct presentation from the mind. Doesn't matter, direct presentation of what doesn't matter. It can even be a direct presentation of imaginary symbolic past. I mean, the forms of it. All that's important is that it's a direct presentation. That's all. And of course, again, spirit cannot accept a direct presentation of mind than being annihilated. So we have to choose a new idea. We have to be willing to not try and change reality, not trying to change what we are, what is, not trying to be prime creator, in order for this to happen. Now, many have had a glimpse of this direct presentation by mind. And then they say, whoa, okay, now how do I explain that? What is that? How do I set that in context of explanation and gradualness? And then they, you know, struggle with it. But where we're at is we don't need to struggle with that anymore. We can accept a direct presentation continually because we understand the context. Which is what is needed now. Because of this polarity conflict that's coming, we need to literally be able to shift into what's like a fifth dimensional condition or state of mind. Really. So we need to be able to accept this continuously, which means we have to know the context of why we're doing this and what's really going on. The big picture. We need the full picture now. Not just little snippets. Again, many have had this a glimpse, a holy instant of mind presenting, directly presenting, whatever, it doesn't matter. You're walking on the beach and they just get the sense, I'm getting a direct presentation. And they say, oh my gosh. And then they spend the rest of their life writing books and talking about it, this experience. I had this experience, you know, everything, I felt at one with everything. I felt at peace and wow, it's amazing. Isn't that incredible? And all this stuff. But we can literally experience this continuously without any trouble. Without any trouble. And we're in a different place now. For me, I say thanks to A Course in Miracles and thanks to Ananda Mayama, those two. And thanks to them, we're on better standing now. Way better. Way better. We're not aiming for just a glimpse and saying, okay, now, let me go out and tell everybody, hey, I had a glimpse. No. There's no more time for that. We're literally being able to now accept the direct presentation of mind, moment by moment by moment, and say, I choose to set down the demand for explanations, and I choose a direct presentation, because I know it's not a direct presentation of annihilation, and it's not leading to that at all. Because I chose a different idea. I chose to accept myself as I am, as I was created to be. So again, we are in a vastly better situation now in relationship to the polarity game. Because the only thing that works now is presence, really. It's the only thing that works. Because we've run out of time for explanations, and the polarity thing is so intense now that it's a gut thing now. It's a bottom line situation. But people will say, hey, either they feel, oh, I don't need to have explained to me what I am. Or they will say, I continue to demand to have it explained to me what I am. One or the other. They will make a decision. And the presence, continual presence, if I dwell in a completely enlightened paradise, that presence of that here, will people will feel it. They will feel it beyond any explanation. In other words, books are no longer useful explanations are really no longer useful. We had to get all our clarification. Now is presence. Presence is what is useful. A little bit of explanation is fine. It's context setting. But that is being eclipsed by presence. And of course, presence means right now. So you can't, it's not enough to have a little glimpse and then be talking, explaining. There have to be those in the world who are in the presence of direct reflection of what they are in that presence of that, experiencing it right now, right now, right now, right now. Because people who are checking out this polarity thing say, uh-oh, they're looking, is there anybody in this presence right now? And then they see that and they say, oh, okay, explanation isn't needed right now. I see that. And then they say, whoa, the polarity game isn't needed right now either. And they say, wow, I don't really need to engage with that right now. Right now. So we have to go beyond words right now. Very important. With the understanding that presence can still use words. Okay. But when we say go beyond words, we mean have as fundamental, presence is fundamental, that's more important. And yet the words can still be there. Okay. You know, it's not like we have to attack words or, you know, get rid of them. It's simply that the right relationship of words has to be there now, that the presence is primary. So presence is primary. At this point, presence is primary. And we are desperately climbing to that point where we can accept presence as primary. The presence meaning someone is accepting direct reflection of what they are. Not using explanation at all. Not using explanation at all. That is presence, what we call presence. And that reassures us, hey, we have a simple choice, one simple choice. To make. Either we demand that what we are be explained to us, or we accept what we are to be directly revealed to us, directly reflected to us. That's it. And presence reveals that simple simplicity of our choice to us. And then we can talk about it, sure. But we're talking about the fact that we have just a simple choice to make. That's okay. That is okay. But how do we remain on point with the fact that we have only a simple choice? Presence is needed to keep us on point with that. Otherwise, our words will quickly devolve into polarity conflict, which happens to me all the time. See, it absolutely happens to everybody. I'm not able to stay on point all the time. And start, you know, looking at the polarity conflict and what people are saying about it, one side, and say, huh, what can I do about this? How do I help? You know, it's a feeling, how do I help? I don't want to get caught up in this, so how do I defuse it? That's the sense that we're all having. We're saying, I don't want to get caught up in this polarity conflict, so how do I defuse it? And then we get caught up in explanations and say, how do I explain to this side? How do I explain? And before you know it, you're all caught up in explanations, right? And then you're enmeshed in the polarity conflict. Again, the answer is to transcend explanations, or to set your demand for explanations down and accept the presence of direct experiencing reflection of what I am. Without the need of any explanation. And recognizing we have a simple choice to make. And then talking about that simple choice, that's fine. Using words in that context is fine. And presence is important. Presence is primary right now. As a helpful tool, presence is primary. Presence is primary right now. Now, can I supply that? It's possible. I don't bank on it. I don't count my chickens before they're hatched, so I'm not banking on that. But it is conceivably possible. One of the listeners, viewers could do it too. Any one of us could do it. Any one of us could do that. But again, it won't necessarily be one of us either too, because it's not something you can absolutely bank on as far as in time. I don't know. but it's certainly possible that somebody simply dropped the demand for explanation of what they are and have it directly revealed to them, and then they're in the presence. They're supplying the presence, just right like that. Could be anyone. Doesn't matter who it is. Doesn't matter. The reassurance is immediate. The reassurance is immediate. And the diffusing of the polarity game is immediate. Theoretically, it's possible that the polarity conflict could be diffused. Theoretically, it is. But can only be diffused in one way, is presence, accepting the directly revealed what I am, is being directly revealed, the presence of that, and then others also accepting the direct reflection of what I am. What I am being directly reflected to me, others accepting that, and then that the diffusing becomes greater and greater and greater because of that. Now, I don't know if it's a 100 monkey type of situation where you get a certain number of people in the world doing that that's automatically it spreads out to the whole world. I'm not banking on that. I don't bank on that. It's a nice little catchy spiritual thing, isn't it? But I don't bank on that. But there could be some quantum effect. There could be some quantum effect, some exponential effect of it. It may be exponential quantum effect rather than just sort of a linear type of momentum. That is possible. The momentum may be greater than we can account for, but I don't think it's some kind of automatic number type of thing. I know people put numbers like 100 enlightened beings in the world. If the presence of 100 of us in the world who accept the direct reflection of what we are, then the whole polarity game is going to be diffused. I don't say that's impossible, but I'm not banking on that. I'm not banking on some number. Don't worry about the number. It's just that it is conceivable, it is possible to diffuse the polarity problem. It is possible. But will it happen? I'm not banking on that happening either. If it happens, it happens. But it will only happen through presence, acceptance of what I am, direct reflection of what I am here. It will only happen because of that, and for no other reason. For no other reason. So, you know, as long as the world is chasing other avenues, you know, it's not going to happen. And you might say, well, gurus, what's their benefit? Well, keep in mind that even though Anandamayi Ma has been dead since 1982, has not been present here as far as physical presence, and people forgot about it pretty much, you know, lost in the dustbin of history. Keep in mind that here I am giving out this information now, right here, right now, in large measure, because the fact that she was here in the first place, and that the reassurance of Anandamayi Ma and Ramana Maharshi, etc., permeated the planet, and I picked up on it, you see. And also because Jesus gave A Course in Miracles that helped set the context for me, which I needed. That provided vast reassurance too. So the fact that one, someone who hasn't been here for 2,000 years and one hasn't been here for 31 years or so now, still, they were extremely helpful. Extremely, extremely helpful. But I would not be here now if it weren't for them. No way, no way, no way. The reassurance was necessary because we have gone through a very a time of extreme polarity, where the temptation to fall into the trap of demanding explanation, it has been so extreme that without enormous reassurance, for sure I would have fallen away, for sure. I was on the edge of falling away continuously the entire time, and sometimes I did sort of really backslide very badly. And It's possible I still could. You know, I'm not banking on anything at this point. So these teachers are extremely helpful, even though they're not even here in this world right now. The reassurance and the presence that they gave is still extremely important, extremely helpful. But if we don't follow up on that and make the choice ourselves, then we will certainly be caught up in the polarity game. Polarity conflict. And again, what is that? It's spoon-feeding us gradual reflection of gradual annihilation of the mind, really. This is the play of the mind, this what we're seeing. And the mind is spoon-feeding to us the gradual annihilation of the mind. And when we're watching, this is a movie of the mind. We're spirit watching a movie the mind is presenting to us. And that's this world, this universe. And what mind is presenting to us is its own gradual annihilation. that's what the movie is. So there are times, because as long as we keep demanding, like, hey, I want to be prime creator, mind, come on, hurry up, then mind will present a very strong dollop of its own annihilation. Kind of like drinking, taking a tablespoon of molasses, which I just bought some molasses. Funny. It's like, whoa, that's strong. Mind has to do this. So there are times when mind will present in the movie of its own complete annihilation a very strong dose of this annihilation to kind of try and, get us more used to it, what's to come. Because we're demanding it of mind, actually. And we're at that time. We are demanding the demand for time, for mind to complete, what it's trying to present to us, because we're tired of this gradualness. Give it to us directly, in other words. It's very strong. And so the mind will give us a very strong dose of its own annihilation. So in other words, the movie becomes a movie of annihilation. And we're perilously close to that point right now. Perilously close. And don't think that the mind can't bring it to us very quickly. It absolutely can. Remember, the mind's in control of this movie. The mind is in control of this movie. And it's the producer of the movie. We are the one who tell the mind what movie to produce. And then the mind does the producing of the movie. And we sit back and experience it. That spirit mind, that's how it works. So we're demanding mind. We want to experience being prime creator. We want you to get that movie done right now. Then mind will say, oh boy, I need to really produce a very strong dose of annihilation of the mind in this movie. The mind being annihilated. And we will get this very, very, and the mind will produce it like that. It's in control. The mind is in control of the movie, not spirit. Spirit is in control of which movie the mind produces, but it's not in control of producing that particular movie. How that movie is produced, mind is. That's its function in reality. So we had better realize that mind can present to us a very strong dollop of its own annihilation. And it can do it like that. Just like a producer in a movie says, okay, folks, we just shot that scene, now we're going to shoot this other scene, and we're going to go to this set right here and do it right now. Now, when you watch the movie, you may think, oh, it took a long time between here and now. But in actually producing it, it can be like that. For instance, you can be in a lighted set and shoot a scene, daytime scene, then the producer says, okay, now we're going to shoot a nighttime scene. Then all the lights are dimmed in the set, and you shoot a nighttime scene. Now, when you're watching the movie, you might think, oh, this nighttime thing was done, 10 hours after this other one or whatever. But in fact, of producing it, it can be done like in a matter of minutes. It's just a matter of dimming the lights, you see. So mind can dim the lights like that. And yet we here are assuming that it's going to take a long time because we're watching the movie as if it's a movie. We don't understand that mind can do it just like that. Just like that. And we get caught unawares. That's why Jesus kept telling us, you have to be alert. It's going to catch you like a thief in the night these times. He'll catch you like a thief in the night if you're not aware and clarified and wise. So we assume, oh well, whatever happens if there's a conflict, it's off in the future, so it'll be, you know, gradual thing. Because we're used to the gradualism that mind is presenting of us with recently. But again, if our demand increases that mind give us this experience we want right now, Prime Creator, that then mind has to make the gradualism less. It becomes more abrupt. The movie becomes more abrupt. Instead of a slow dimming of the lights in the production room, this world is like a production studio. Instead of slowly dimming them so it mimics, like, you know, from daylight going to nighttime, mind can dim the lights in the studio very quickly. And so in a matter of like 3 minutes, it goes from bright studio daylight scene to dark, dark, dismal. We can't see anything, it's all dark, you know, in a matter of 3 minutes or something, right? Or it could dim it just immediately. It won't do that, but it could be very quick. And then it will shock us, like, whoa, wait a minute. What happened to the gradualism? You know, I'm not used to such gradual, so quickly. It's still gradualism, but it's much quicker. Because we've demanded that of mind, you see? So, again, it can absolutely come like a thief in the night. And pretty much that's what I've seen. At least that possibility is most definitely there, unless we back off of it. Presence can help us back off of that. And then the gradualness gets slowed down. Say, whoa, we don't need to do it so fast. And then it can be slowed down even more. And then we get to the point where we say, oh, we don't need any gradualness at all. We don't need any explanation at all. But we certainly can back off of it. And we say, wait a minute. No, I don't really need to have this idea presented to me, because I can choose a new idea. So it can be, I can back off of this suddenness, you know, come back way off of it, way off of it. The fifth dimension might be a situation where we back way, way off of it. And then beyond the fifth dimension is a situation where we drop the demand for explanations entirely, entirely. But we certainly can back off of it, the suddenness. We certainly can. We're trying to. The world is the struggle. Do we demand this suddenness, or do we back it off? That's the struggle. So we might be able to avert it. We might be able to avert the troubles if we back off of it. But again, the backing off of it has to be done through some acceptance of presence, of directly experiencing what we are without any need for any explanation. So we can do it. It's possible. And on the other hand, it's also possible that we don't do it. It's very possible that we don't back off. That is definitely a possibility, a strong possibility. But again, I don't want to say it's either one or the other, because we could back off of it too. And it, you know, it is possible. It's our choice. It's our choice, really. Is it known whether we back off of it or not? Yeah, probably. It's already known. But again, I don't like to look at it in that way. That's a demoralizing way to look at it. And so I would say that, look, let us continue to engage with presence. With real presence, with actual presence. Not a symbol of the presence. You know, we can trick ourselves easily. Easily, and we do. Instead of, like, let's say someone's like taking on to my mom, you know, we can trick ourselves into saying, she had a female body. That means the female body is the presence. That's deceiving ourselves. Or we say, oh, she was Indian. That means an Indian is the presence, or a female Indian is the presence. That's deluding ourselves. No, the presence is the presence. None of that is relevant. It's totally irrelevant. Totally. But we easily deceive ourselves into thinking, oh, I need to find an Indian woman in order to experience the presence or something. No, it's not true. It's not true at all. It has nothing to do with it. It could be an Aborigine from Australia, a boy Aborigine from Australia, or it could be an old white man from Nova Scotia or something. You know, it has absolutely nothing to do with place or race or gender or anything as far as form goes. It has to do with the actual presence itself, which is acceptance of what I am, direct reflection, direct revealing of what I am, instead of any explanation of what I am. In other words, the mind is, someone's accepted the mind to present directly. Doesn't matter who it is. And there is no carryover based on the characteristics of that person. You know, do they have long hair, short hair? How do they look? No relevance in terms of someone else having presence. None. And yet we very easily fall into that trap of thinking, I need to find somebody that looked like them. So in other words, if I want to find this direct presence, I need to find somebody that looked like them, you know, and then people fake it, of course. They dress up, they mimic presence to get you to sucker you into giving them your attention, etc. And then they use you in very bad ways. That happens all the time. But presence is undeniable. When you see it, it's undeniable. It's undeniable. You know it. You say, oh, this one is in a state of direct revealing with who they are. Continual direct revealing is taking place. The mind is presenting directly to them. You know it. You know it right away. But when there isn't that direct presence, you can't. Then you get desperate and you start clinging, clutching for straws, and say, "Well, let me find somebody that looks like somebody else who was here before, and maybe, you know, they have the same look and hair, and everything's the same, you know, the way they, their race, their gender, the way they talk, and everything, and maybe that's the presence." No, it's not. It's not. That's an explanation. That's going for explanation. Instead, you know, we feel safer that way. We avoid the direct presence, and we use someone who's in the explanation mode of that. So what I'm using the explanation for is to explain how we need to go beyond explanation. So that's a justified form of explanation. I've tried to always use explanation in that direction, absolutely in that direction. You need that which is dropped explanation, mind directly presenting. Whoever it is, doesn't matter. Makes no difference. And yet those who want explanation insist that it fit in to what came before. Like somebody, some saint came before, they say, no, whoever comes next has to look like them, has to fit into them, has to be like that. They demand it because they want to explain it all. See, they want an explanation. That's the problem. We're dropping the demand for explanations of who we are, what we are. It's simply we accept mind presenting to us directly of anything. So therefore it doesn't matter who you are or what your physical body is or anything. That orange tree, you know, mind can directly present that to me. If I accept direct presentation, it could be an orange tree. I used to see, oh, that's directly being presented to me directly. I accept it. Direct, and that's the important thing, is direct presentation. That's reality. That gets us used to reality once again, instead of gradual, incomplete presentation, which is explanation instead of explanation. Effect as explanation. We've dropped that. We've dropped it. So again, anybody can do this matter. You can take the worst prisoner in the world in some solitary. They can drop the demand for explanation, have the mind direct presentation. They can be the guru too. Anybody can be the guru. Anybody can be the presence in any circumstance, in any place, in time and space. Anyone can do that. Simply make the simple choice and say, choose between an explanation of what I am or a direct revealing of what I am. Choose a direct revealing of what I am. The presence is there immediately. The presence is there. And what they were before in terms of demanding explanation doesn't make any difference at that point. It's irrelevant, completely irrelevant. Also, you get the ones who have done that. You get this sense of this complete irrelevance of anything like that. There's no relevance to that. There's no relevance to explanation in that way at all. You get that sense. And that's kind of a shocker. Because we wanted this narration, you see. We want the mind is narrating to us a story, an explanation. So we want this narration of, okay, this one's enlightened, this one, and this one, and what's the story between them, and what's the narration, and all this stuff. We want this explanation. Which again, we want to be prime creator, which necessitates this explanation of annihilation. That's what it really is. We're used to that. We cling to it. But we have to go beyond that. Let something be presented to us directly. Whatever, it doesn't matter what it is. We're always searching for something. I want to go to Hawaii. Is it maybe if I go to Hawaii, I'll get this feeling of direct presentation of what I am. I used to live around when I was young, when I was still feeling a direct presentation of everything to me. And so, of course, in my mind, I think Hawaii is a place of direct presentation. No, it's not. It's just that I was young then and still not fallen in the ways of explanation of what I am. So I felt a sense of direct presentation. It had to do with the fact that I was quite young at the time. Didn't have anything to do with Hawaii. Didn't have anything to do with it. The actual place had nothing to do with it. It had to do with my own mind, my own spirit. So you can accept direct presentation right where you are. It makes no difference. It's not about where you are really. But we always think that if we just go somewhere else, there'll be some place that directly presents itself to us, you know, like go on vacation somewhere, nice place. Now, it's true, for instance, if I went to Hawaii, I might remember when I was younger, I might bring up some memories, like, I remember when everything was directly presented to me, and that might help out, or might not actually, you know, I don't know, but it's not that important. You go to a beautiful place, you might feel, I feel empowered to directly experience. That is possible. It's possible. When you're in a place, certain places, I've experienced a feeling like I have permission to drop explanation of what I am. That is true. I have had those places. But it doesn't last. It's not strong enough. Like out on a private golf course where there was nobody else out there, I felt like I can just drop explanation of what I am. I don't need to even explain anything at all anymore. I can just sit here. Problem is, though, you get someone playing along behind you, and they're going to come up, and they're going to wonder why you're just sitting there in the green or just not doing anything. And you feel you might need to explain what you're doing. You just play through, and they go, okay. But there's a sense like, sometimes in places and situations, a sense that you don't need to explain yourself. place where we feel we don't need to explain what we are, right? We have a grave there. But we have to go beyond the idea that it's a time and place that we get that from, because that doesn't work. There's always a demand for explanation from the world. We have to get it directly from the mind, go beyond explanation, and be in that light, enlightened condition, and then call others to that presence. That is what is necessary. Yeah, I've been seeking some place where the demand for explanation isn't there. I'll go off in some jungle, you know, or forest. I'll always go off the path and just go somewhere, get completely lost, just away, so nobody, there's no feeling of somebody demanding you explain yourself. But can't really find that anymore in the world. Cannot find it. Because then someone will say, oh, you're missing, and everyone will go looking for you. Or, you know, someone eventually, you feel, wait, I need to explain why, what, where have I been for all this time, you know? It's impossible. So it's better to do it this way. Better to do it this way. This is what works. This is what works. The other way is futile. I understand the quest. You know, I want to be on some beach in southwestern Africa, you know, where there's nobody for 100 miles in any direction. And I'm just walking along the beach, and then I feel like I don't have any need to explain anything to anybody. You know, that kind of thing. But then you have to worry about my food, you know, and shelter, and people who know me, they're thinking, well, where is he? And when you show up again, eventually you explain, where have you been? And, you know, it doesn't really work. The logistics of it all are very difficult, too. It doesn't really work. But short of the satsang, then we're kind of stuck with, like, hey, yeah, I mean, maybe I have to find a way to just totally drop out, completely drop out. That was the 60s. Tune in, turn on, drop out. That wasn't it. That wasn't it. I found out that's not it. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. But the yearning there is to go beyond explanation. But we just weren't, we didn't quite get it yet of what we needed to do. But now at this point, we do get it. We do get it. We're a totally different place than the 60s now. Entirely. Entirely. Way wiser right now. We are way wiser than we were in the 60s and the 70s, etc. Way wiser. If we using the time correctly, we're a way more advanced situation where we don't need to go searching for all those, you know, Shambhala somewhere. Shambhala is that dead leaf over there, being mind presenting it directly. That is Shambhala. That is Nirvana. That is Nirvana. This one over here. Let me see if I can pause this. Alright, so I have to go do something, but Shambhala is right here. Nirvana is right here. Heaven is right here. It is the direct experiencing, direct presentation, direct reflection of what I am. Mind presenting directly. That is Nirvana. And it's right where you are with anything at all. Anything at all. It's just one. You just have to accept that whatever there is, whatever around you, is right here with you. You don't have to go anywhere. You don't have to do anything. It's an acceptance of direct presentation, as it were. No explanation, direct reflection. Mind presenting directly of anything. Anything. The air. Presenting the air to you directly. The air right here, right where you are. The sounds, right where you are. The taste, the hunger, anything directly presented. That is Nirvana. That is Samadhi. That is Shambhala. That is paradise. That is enlightenment. And it's available to you immediately, right where you are, without any exception whatsoever. And now I do have to go do stuff in the world and help out a little bit here and there. Okay, so very great If you've watched this video, you can sense there's one simple step away, one simple clear step away, one choice away. Either choose explanation, either demand explanation of what I am, or I accept direct revelation of what I am. So stay in the awareness of that simple choice. It's your choice. It's everyone's choice. You can make that choice right here, right now. Very great. That's it for this one. Direct perception of what I am. No explanation needed. Direct perception. Direct perception of what I am. Direct perception of what I am. I allow myself to be revealed. No explanation needed. Direct perception of what I am. Allow myself to stand revealed. Be directly reflected. No explanation needed. No explanation needed. Let my perception of this be direct. Let my perception, let this reflect what I am directly, without any need, without any explanation. Let this reflect what I am directly, without any explanation. Direct perception of what I am. No need for any explanation. Direct perception of what I am. Let what I am stand revealed directly, without any explanation. Let what I am stand revealed. Directly revealed. Without any explanation whatsoever. Let I am stand revealed. No explanation required. No story required. Direct reflection of what I am. No explanation required. Direct reflection of what I am. No explanation required. Explanations required for what I am. I am what I am. Only revelation can reveal me unto myself. Explanation cannot. No call for explanation. No call for explanations. No call for explanations. No call for explanations. Myself stands revealed unto me. Let myself stand revealed unto me without the need of any explanations.